their day begins the same way. For Sugar Ray Leonard, it starts on the edge of the Atlantic. For Marvelous Marvin Hagler, the sun will rise 3 hours later on the edge of the desert.
Marvelous Marvin Hagler!
They have both battled their way toward this moment.
I knew it would happen, but never knew when.
Now you're not a commentator anymore. Let's not talk about commentating. Let's talk about fighting now, because you're in there.
After years of waiting, they will finally come together.
This is a dream that has become a reality.
This is war, too. And I come to fight.
At last. But will it be better late than never? For 5 years it was a dream fight, fought only in imaginations. A fight cut down in its prime, like Ray Leonard, by injury. A violent dance undanced. Hello, I'm Larry Merchant. And now that the dance is on, we're going to try to answer some questions and question some answers about it. Why is Ray Leonard coming back? Not only against the fearsome Marvin Hagler, but without any tune-up fights. Is it merely the need of a prematurely grounded high flyer to fly again? Or is it the money? Big, big, big money. Or both? Is Leonard too glibly risking serious re-injury to himself and perhaps boxing? And finally, can he be competitive? Or will the fight be an anticlimax? Marvin Hagler is one of the most admirable athletes of his time, fighting all comers, always giving his best. But after diligently and even desperately pursuing the status he's won, is he risking it all? The price of their risks is certainly right. Guarantees of $12 million to Hagler, $11 million to Ray Leonard. And the contrast in their styles, their personalities, and their journeys to this showdown is the stuff of pure drama, as correspondent Barry Tompkins discovered.
Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. Robert Frost wrote those words in his poem, The Road Not Taken. But they might serve as a fitting lament for Marvelous Marvin Hagler, as he thinks about the road taken by Sugar Ray Leonard. Leonard took the high road. Hagler has taken the rocky road. On April 6th, finally, their paths will cross.
From the beginning, Ray Charles Leonard was not your ordinary boxer. He didn't have to fight, but he did, just for fun, in his middle-class neighborhood of Palmer Park, Maryland. The road began in 1976 when he captured the gold medal, and with it the hearts of millions at the Montreal Summer Olympic Games. America had a new hero, and Sugar Ray Leonard would be on a pedestal for years to come. And then there was Marvin Hagler, the youngster who had to protect himself growing up during the 1967 riots in Newark, New Jersey. He was of the streets, but with an inbred passion to rise above it. It wouldn't be easy. Nothing like that of his opponent. Marvin Hagler never attended the Olympics. He turned professional in 1973 and had fought 32 opponents before Leonard earned his first paycheck. But Sugar Ray's debut was a little bit different than Hagler's.
By Leonard making 40 grand and then another six or whatever for television rights or whatever, the guy walked away 46,000. My first fight, I made $50.
I think there's a bit of resentment there that Marvin feels that I've taken a shortcut. But I didn't take a shortcut. Damn it, I worked just as hard as he did, and maybe harder.
Everything seemed to come easier for Leonard when he won the world welterweight title, beating Wilfred Benitez in his 26th professional fight. Celebration followed. For Hagler, his middleweight title took 54 fights, When he beat Alan Minter, the celebration was more of a riot. The London crowd bombarded him with bottles.
Sugar Ray!
One was a celebrity. The other, a warrior. No one questioned who was the favorite.
He holds it against me. I think he holds it against everyone. Marvin becomes somewhat of a bitter person because he feels that he had to go the long way to make it to the top.
When he defeated Thomas Hearns to become the undisputed champion, Ray Leonard was considered one of the greatest welterweights of all time. But no matter how destructive the Marvelous One was, he still felt neglected through all the years.
I'm just trying to show the people that I am the best middleweight champion of the world, letting the people know that I am a champion. What do I have to do to get the recognition? Do I have to kill somebody?
As time droned on, Marvin knew there was one person who could give him the recognition he so much desired. His thoughts were expressed as far back as 1981, when he took over the HBO microphone for a fighting Leonard.
One day, I believe that if we do ever fight, it would be the biggest fight that anybody ever seen.
3 months later, they drew even closer after Leonard won the junior middleweight title against Ayub Kaluli.
God, Marvin Hagler is one of the greatest middleweight champions in the world. And somewhere down the line, he deserves a big payday, and I will give him that.
After the Hearns fight, while training to fight Roger Stafford, Leonard suffered a detached retina. The big payday was now in question.
If Ray Leonard does decide that's enough, I've had it, I'm not going to have
you
a go at Marvin.
You got to make some of that money. I'm tired of people telling me how generous he is and how good friends we are. If I'm such a good friend, give me that big payday then. That's what we want. We want to show real artists and everything else out there, and I believe that it's us that can do it.
9 days later, Marvin was again upstaged by Leonard's show.
A fight with this great man, this great champion, could be one of the greatest fights in the history of boxing. Talking about money, you talk about Fort Knox. And this is the only man who could ever make that possible, Marvelous Marvin Hagler. But unfortunately, it'll never happen.
And it irked me a little bit, because deep down inside, the real Ray Leonard wanted to fight this guy. You know, I wanted to fight him then. But I never knew when it was going to happen. I knew it would happen, but never knew when.
And 2 years later, he announced his return.
Yes, it's not a comeback. I'm back.
But the comeback was unsuccessful. Leonard, once again, had had enough.
He can take him at any time. And a right hand from Kevin Howard put Sugar Ray Leonard.
While an attending Hagler would now be the master of his own fate and the master of his sport.
You know who the public wants? You can ask them. I'm going to tell you, he better come and get me before I decide that I don't want him.
And finally, after a devastating victory over Thomas Hearns, Marvelous Marvin Hagler was king of boxing as he took over the celebrity status that once belonged to Sugar Ray Leonard.
Hey. You ready? Just for the marvelous feeling. Rolling. Action.
They'll make you feel like a million.
I feel as though that the time is my time right now, and he's in my time. You know, his time was when he first came out the Olympics and all that stuff before he retired the first time. He should have stayed out of the game.
But there was one fight Ray Leonard would come out of retirement for.
What I'm saying here is I want to fight him. I'll sit by my phone, okay? If he should say, Ray, I will fight you, I would consider it very highly. It'd be something I couldn't really turn down.
I've been humiliated, you know, especially behind the fact that he hasn't took him so long to get his heart up together, you know, to come out. I think that I've hunted this man so long that finally my time has came where he knew that I got to fight this guy.
And now there's talk that you might not fight him. Is that true?
Well, you know, right now it's really hitting a lot of press. I think basically just has an ego. He's on an ego trip or something. Yeah. A little jealousy. You know, he's missing the limelight a little bit. But the way that I feel about it, I'm just going to sit back and I'm just going to lick my chops. and just wait. No. But, John, what I'm going to do is next month we're going to hold a press conference and then I'm going to answer Leonard's challenge. And I might say, yeah.
He did. And that began the psychological fight and then the rhetorical fight. And then, finally, on April 6th, the real fight.
I'll take this time to thank Marvelous Marvin Hagler.
Now I have the opportunity to finally show the world that I am the best fighter in the world.
Much of it trying to make it in the movies. That didn't work, so money brought him back to the ring against Gene Tunney. Dempsey looked to be in shape, but he clearly wasn't the legendary whirlwind who revolutionized prize fighting with his reckless style. And Tunney easily defeated him, boxing rings around him. Dempsey then retired, unretired, and lost to Tunney again. Tunney was one of the few champs who stayed retired when he finally did retire.
Ray Leonard is trying to defy history. Muhammad Ali's first retirement and comeback, also 3 years, were involuntary. He couldn't get a fight license because of his conscientious objection to military service during the Vietnam War. But Ali took two tough tune-ups before meeting Joe Frazier. He lost to Frazier, his first defeat, but he kept at it and ultimately recaptured the title and beat Frazier twice. Ali proved that serious comebacks can be successful.
Comeback fights don't work. They don't work. Look at boxing history. Forget about the names Leonard and Hagler. Forget. Call them Fighter A and Fighter B. If Fighter B is the fighter who comes out of retirement, boxing history will show you it doesn't work.
Comebacks, if not comeback fights, do work, however. As Sugar Ray Robinson showed as well. The man regarded as pound for pound the greatest of fighters retired at 32 to try his hand in show business. 2.5 years later, he was performing where he performed best, in the ring. But he came back slowly and deliberately, not for one big shot, but as a fighter. After 6 tune-ups, one of which he lost, he challenged Bobo Olsen, and as the underdog, proceeded to knock him out to win the middleweight title a third time.
Hey guys, I'm back.
Ray Leonard made that celebrated comeback in 1984.
I've been really up for this fight. I've trained really hard, and I'm going to put everything into this fight.
Howard is actually pressing this fight right at the moment. And it's almost as though Sugar Ray Leonard is asking himself what he needs to do against what he knows is an inferior opponent.
Though he looked as good as could be expected, it wasn't up to his high standard. It was a prelude for another farewell.
And the fight is over.
If I didn't feel it tonight, I never will feel it. And I'm not going to push it. I'm not going to take a chance, though. I just felt that it's not there. I know if it wasn't there tonight, it never will be. There's no sense in me taking any further chances.
Leonard said that all the punches hurt, but here he is again.
This fight is not what you saw in 1984, because that wasn't a challenge. I won't come back, but I'll fight Marvin. And I honestly mean that. This is not a career for me. This is one fight. This is a dream that has become a reality.
Comeback is official, but the circumstances seem to have changed for both fighters. Barry, Ray has fought once in 5 years. Marvin has only fought once in 2 years. How's that reflected in what's going on in the camps?
I don't really know if it is reflected, to tell you the truth. I think both camps are business as usual. They're the same, and yet they're different. And I think they're the same in that they are business as usual, but they're different in that at Ray's camp, Ray's the boss. Nobody else, just Ray. In Marvin's camp, it's the three of them. It's Pat Petronelli, he's got his job. Goody Petronelli, he's the trainer, he's got his job. And Marvin Hagler is the warrior. And the three of them collectively make decisions. At Ray's camp, it's just one. I might add one other thing. If looks win fights, then this fight is dead even. Both of them look ready right now.
But, of course, Marvin Hagler showed up 11 weeks before the fight, usually 6 weeks before a fight, which indicates how serious he's taking this. What about the reports, curious reports, out of Ray's camp that he hadn't been training hard every day? At one period, 7 days out of 10, he wasn't in the gym. Then they said he was fighting these real fights with referees to get in shape, and then that proved to be a little bit of a fib. Are they covering up? Are they jollying him? What is all that about?
It's really hard to say. I think any fight camp has a lot of guys around who are the attaboy guys. You know, they're patting you on the back saying, you're doing a great job. You look good, champ. You're ready to go. I asked Jenks Morton about just that very thing. Now, Jenks is the head trainer, and if anybody runs a camp other than Ray Leonard, then it's Jenks Morton. And he said, it's true, we have been a little bit sporadic from time to time, but the reason for that is that Ray was ready. Ray was peaking too early for Jenks Morton. And so Jenks felt that the time off and appearing at basketball games and going up home for the weekends was good, not bad.
Still seems a little curious, I have to admit, that far in advance of the fight. But what with the Tower report on President Reagan's management style and team, we'll have to look at the Tompkins report now and the management style and teams of Hagler and Leonard.
All right, you shouldn't be there. I don't want you speed going.
Gotta get it going.
Yeah.
You're way better than that.
Come on, Ray. You gotta be quicker. You gotta take it away from him. Okay?
Just gotta keep pumping like that, Bobby. Gotta keep pumping. Understand?
Okay, go ahead.
What?
All right.
This is where most of the action will take place come April the 6th, in the center of a 20-foot square. But when it comes to winning and losing the fight, this is where most of the action will be, in a much smaller area of that square. In that corner over there, Marvelous Marvin Hagler and the Petronelli brothers had been with Marvin since age 16. In this corner, Sugar Ray Leonard's, the triumvirate of Angelo Dundee, Jenks Morton, and Dave Jacobs. They have just about an equal tenure. Two camps with a common goal, but different ideas of how to get there. Dawn in Palm Springs. The only sound one hears is the chirping of the birds and the running feet of the fighter. It will have been 13 months out of the ring when Hagler squares off against Leonard, his longest layoff. Since he knocked out Thomas Hearns 2 years ago, he's had one fight. The Petronellis have their champion in camp 5 weeks early. There's plenty to be done.
I talked to my brother Pat and Marvin. We thought we'd get there a little earlier so we wouldn't have to rush. We have a time schedule. We know what we have to do to get ready for the fight. And at home, he was being bothered with a lot of endorsements. He has a store he has to run, and he has his family and his wife he has to cater to. And it was a little bit too much for him to get his fanny down the gym.
In a lot of ways, I thought it was crazy myself, but I leave it all up to Goody and Pat. We all kind of put our head together. That's what we call the triangle. We put our head together, and we see what's beneficial. And so far, this has been good. No rush program, taking your time, going to school, in a sense. My corner people, as long as we're working very hard and whatever, they're having a very tough time on for this particular fight on trying to keep me down, like a racehorse, you know, trying to get out of the stable. I realize the importance of this fight. I have that little extra than what Ray has. I get the best teachers in the world.
And 2,000 miles east in Hilton Head, South Carolina, Ray Leonard is also at work. Although his training philosophy varies from that of his adversary, and unlike Hagler's team concept, there's no doubt who's boss in the Leonard camp. Even though the circumstances have changed drastically with the comeback, his camp continues to operate the same way as when Leonard was pound for pound the best fighter in the world. Even his most recognizable trainer, Angelo Dundee, still doesn't appear until the fight draws close.
I don't think it would make any difference for me being up there, right there at this moment, because from the beginning of the training, of Sugar Ray Leonard, I've always went in there a couple, 3 weeks before a fight, according to the impact of the fight.
With Angelo Dundee, I mean, this is nothing new. Angelo has always come in weeks prior to the fight. I mean, for those that say, well, a trainer should be there all the time. These two guys train me, Dave Jacobs and Jenks Morton. Angelo is my trainer, and Angelo is doing his work on the other side of the town.
Tuning up Ray is no problem. He gets in shape. He's a hard training guy. Ray's never had no problem working. He's that kind of an individual.
While Dundee stays at home studying films, Leonard's in good hands with longtime trainers Morton and Jacobs. But you can be certain that come fight night, it'll be Dundee doing the talking.
You've got 9 minutes. You're blowing it now, son. You're blowing it.
Ray will do his thing. The importance of the corner, not that important, especially when you had a talent like a Sugar Ray Leonard sitting on that stool that knows what he wants to do.
Well, it's all worked in the past, but could Dundee be underestimating the importance of the corner in this fight? Hagler's handlers, on the other hand, realize in a fight as big as this, it can be won or lost in the corner.
We keep control corner. We don't get excited. If I get excited, he's going to get excited, which is common sense. When the fighter comes back to the corner, we pretty much know what we're going to tell him. I mean, we've been together so long, we know each other. I can look at Marvin like I'm looking at you right now. He knows what I'm thinking, and most of the time I know what he's thinking.
The question remaining is whether or not Marvin Hagler can adapt and adjust should Ray Leonard frustrate him. He didn't against Duran when the Petronellis gave the champion the wrong advice, having him box with the three-time champion and not slug with him. That advice almost cost Hagler his title. And conversely, will Ray Leonard be willing to listen to his corner in this fight, which he didn't do when he fought Duran the first time, abandoning his normal boxing style and trying to go toe-to-toe with the Panamanian. Not sticking to his corner's fight plan cost him the fight. Two fighters in their corners, each on a mission, which after April 6th, only one will have accomplished.
Team Hagler and Team Leonard also include a Mrs. Hagler and a Mrs. Leonard, and both are known as strong-willed women
who oppose their fighters fighting at all again.
In their own way, probably stronger than Mr. Hagler and Mr. Leonard, to tell you the truth. Bertha Hagler, I think, perhaps even more adamantly against this fight than was Juanita Leonard. But Marvin told me they went up to their place in New Hampshire, had a long talk about it, a weekend-long talk about it, and finally it was decided, yes, this fight will happen. Bertha went her way. She went to Massachusetts, and Marvin, as is his wont, went the other way. He went to Palm Springs. Does not like to have his wife around training camp. Juanita Leonard, on the other hand, likes to be around Ray Leonard's training camp, and Ray likes to have her around. She is an extremely good judge of character, according to Ray, and she keeps the hangers-on sort of away, and she's very good at deciding this person's important and should be here. This person, frankly, is in the way. He also, oddly enough, listens to his son, Ray Jr. I think he sees an awful lot of himself in his oldest son.
What is your take, then, on this whole scene, the fight, since you've been examining it?
Marvin Hagler is as relaxed and as confident as I've ever seen him be. It's a different kind of confidence than he's had in the past. I almost had the sense in fights past that he was trying to convince himself that he was going to be able to win this fight. I think he's absolutely convinced that he can beat Sugar Ray Leonard. And in fact, I think he's trying to find a way to really dislike Sugar Ray Leonard. I think he's having a little bit of trouble with that, but he always says he needs to dislike the man he's in there against. As to Ray Leonard, I had a long talk with him not terribly long ago in a really kind of a quiet setting, and he said, I know how to beat Marvin Hagler, and he explained to me how to beat Marvin Hagler, and I think he's right. He probably does know how to beat Marvin Hagler, but I got to thinking about it, and I thought, well, I know how to slam dunk a basketball, but until I lower the basket to 8 feet, I'm not going to be able to do it, and I think that's the bottom line.
It'll be a little harder to slam dunk Marvin Hagler, because once the bell rings, there are no teams or wives. There are just two guys doing what they do best. The conventional wisdom is that Leonard will try to neutralize and frustrate the aggressive Hagler with boxing tactics, hitting, holding, moving. And this choreography was shaped by Roberto Duran.
Time was when Marvelous Marvin Hagler, like Rocky Balboa, felt he had something to prove. He had to prove to Sugar Ray Leonard that he could box just like Ray Leonard. But that was when Sugar Ray Leonard dictated the tempo of boxing. Now, Marvelous Marvin Hagler plays the tunes, and Sugar Ray Leonard does the dancing. If recent history holds true, Marvelous Marvin Hagler's tactics have been get in and get out. If you ask him about strategy on April 6th, his answer is very simple.
I'm planning on going in there and ripping his whole face off if I have to. I got H-U-R-T written in my mind, and that's hurt.
I'm not known to be a big puncher. I'm known to be a consistent puncher. And the first one doesn't get you, I'll get you with the next one.
2 minutes remaining. A right hand, and that hurts on the first sentence, really. Hearns is not down yet. A left hand, as Ray thought his man was going to go, and he didn't, and Hearns is still on his feet. For the most part, the strategy on the night of April 6th is cut and dry. The champion feels he has to do what he's done in the past, and that's use his strength, cut off the ring, and physically punish his opponent. The challenger, Ray Leonard, feels he has to utilize his quickness, his hand speed, and hope to accumulate points as the fight progresses. And as in many fights, the first round could set the tempo.
That first round is a key round. It's a very important round. But, you know, I tell you, it's what I'm thinking about doing is the fact, what I'm hoping to do, rather, is just before the bell rings, land the last punch. And the reason I say that is because he has to go back to his corner saying, damn, he can hit.
I'm going to get attention somewhere before the end of the first round. No matter how he think he's looking or how quick he's going to be, but I'm going to get you. I'm going to get you some kind of way in the first round. You're going to know that you're going to be in a fight, partner.
I don't anticipate another Hearns first round. I really don't. But who knows when that bell sounds, because sometimes something may tick him off, and it could be. If Leonard makes a mistake, he's going
to
pay.
Many think it would be a big mistake for Leonard to try and trade shots with Hagler. Once before, he tried that strategy, and it failed.
I was very upset the way Ray fought Duran the first time, naturally. We were all upset. The second fight he fought was, you saw the real Sugar Ray Leonard. He put a whipping on Duran, and Duran said, adios.
For Leonard to be effective, he has to outbox and frustrate Hagler, using his defensive skills and his quickness, thereby offsetting Hagler's game plan, as Ray did when he fought Duran the second time, and as Duran did when he fought Hagler.
Duran fought a very intelligent fight, very tactical fight, because Hagler was not able to knock Duran out. Duran was in front of him, but Duran gave him a lot of up and body movement, and I couldn't hit him. people expect me to run, just move around a lot. I won't move around, although I won't slug, quite naturally, it's not helpful. But I see myself being somewhat of a elusive target with great upper body movement.
I hope Leonard did see something from that fight, because everything else was working, all except that I was getting tagged with the right hand. Didn't hurt me. It wasn't hurt at all in the fight. I couldn't understand what had happened, but I do now. I gave Duran a lot of respect, and that's what I did. I got caught up in Duran, again, trying to outbox him and everything, and I lost the first few rounds.
Hagler did his homework after the Duran fight and gave a lesson to Thomas Hearns, knocking him out in the third round, going back to basics, which he'll likely do against Leonard. With Hagler's aggressive style, one has to wonder how Leonard will fare against a legitimate middleweight. When he has fought bigger fighters, like former junior middleweight champion Ayub Kalouli, and in his last comeback against Kevin Howard, Ray had a tendency to fight flat-footed and found himself getting hit with more punches than he would have liked to. Even Ray doesn't really think he'll knock Marvin out, but how will he react should Hagler come at him in the reckless style he did against Hearns and Mugabe?
I honestly can't tell you what I'm going to do. Because I don't know what I'm going to do, because I don't know how I'm going to react if I see a big guy running at me. This is a very rare type of athlete that I'm facing on April 6th. He's that kind of guy that when he punches, it's like an automatic switch that's been turned on. He keep punching, The other guys respected me a great deal, so I had an edge there. I don't think I will get that much respect from Hagler until I initiate that respect.
The same way Leonard's layoff is a factor, Hagler by no means is fighting regularly himself, and therefore it could be to Leonard's advantage if the fight does go the distance. It's also no secret the champion cuts.
And don't make me bleed. I fight harder when I bleed. You know, I know that because I get to a thing of my losing my security of my title. And my title means everything to me. And then I know that I gotta hurt you real bad, and I gotta hurt you the quickest way I know how.
The sum of it all is that the onus lies squarely on Sugar Ray Leonard to prove to the world he still has his innate skills against a champion who's determined to
testing the winners of prize fights is more than an exact science. It goes beyond the knowable to the unknowable, to the intuitive. So we have collected a panel of knowledgeable as well as intuitive fight experts. And they are Gil Clancy, the boxing analyst for CBS, Alex Wallow, the boxing analyst for ABC, and Michael Katz, columnist for the New York Daily News. First, gentlemen, do you have any reservations about this fight taking place at all from the point of view of Ray Leonard's eye and of the match being made, an ex-welterweight champion inactive fighting an active middleweight champion?
By reservation, I don't have any reservations in terms of Ray's health. I think Ray understands his health better than we do. I have no reservations about the fact that it's a guy coming back after 5 years of relative inactivity. What I do have reservations about is the hype about the fight, because this really is nothing more than a crackerjack old-timers day. We have a welterweight champion over the hill. We have a middleweight champion over the hill. And it's an intriguing fight, but I don't think it's Hagler versus Leonard, the Hagler and Leonard that we really think about.
I think that's correct. In terms of the reservations about the medical aspect of Ray's eye, I don't have any reservations simply because I'm not an eye expert, and the man who is advising Ray, Dr. Ronald Michaels, is one of the one or two most respected eye experts in this country. And if Ronald Michaels says that Ray Leonard's eye is at no more risk than any other fighter's eye, then I'm willing to accept his word. In terms of what Mike said, I do think this is two great fighters over the hill that can lead, though, to great fights in the sense of a thrill in Manila kind of fight when Ali and Frazier were both over the hill but had a very memorable exhibition.
Well, the reservations, Larry, that I might have about the fight is the fact that there's always Monday morning quarterbacks, and if, in fact, in the fight, Ray Leonard does get licked and possibly gets hurt, which can happen in any fight, the Monday morning quarterbacks are going to come back and say, see, I told you, he shouldn't have fought, despite the expert medical opinion.
And do you think that could jeopardize boxing in the present climate?
Yes. That's my reservations about the fight. It's a fight that, if it lives up to the hype, which very few fights do live up to the hype, it will be fine. But if something happens, it could be very damaging to boxing. And I'm in the boxing business. I wouldn't like to see that happen.
The other point I'd like to make, disagreeing with my friend Mike Katz, I don't see how you can call a fighter like Marvin Hagler over the hill. You become an over-the-hill fighter when you start to get licked or if you start to take beatings in their very, very close fights. He's done a pretty good job his last three or four fights.
As a former trainer and manager, Gil, what have you seen in fighters coming back after long layoffs? Where are they damaged most?
They're damaged most in the fact that they're not used to the tough competition. Once they get in that ring and they start to take the punishment that they haven't felt for, however, in Ray's case, 4.5 years, I think it can be very, very damaging to them. The competitive edge is lost. Also, their reflexes seem to go a little bit, but perhaps that's just the age going by.
Is that competitive edge what we're talking about in terms of rust, milliseconds of indecisiveness or lack of quickness?
I don't think the competitive edge is gone from Ray. I think it may be gone from Marvin more because I think Marvin, who used to be so active, has been fighting on a schedule of once a year. And I don't think Marvin wants to fight anymore. I think Marvin has made his money. I think he realizes his reflexes have slowed down. When I say over the hill, Gil, I mean he is no longer on top. I mean he is on the descent. And I don't think there's any question about that. I think Ray's problem is that he is now approaching 31, and he is no longer the young Ray Leonard that we remember, the marvelous, you know, like, intuitive fighter who could see punches coming before they were thrown and who could bend his body out of the way. This is stiffness now.
What are the consequences for both of these men in this fight? If Ray Leonard were to lose badly, not be able to really compete, would it damage the aura that's always surrounded him of this sunshine kid that everybody loved? And as for Hagler, would it damage all of the good that he has accumulated for himself to lose to a guy who's fought only once in 5 years?
Well, I don't think that people tend to judge people. Fighters don't tend to get judged on their final fights. I'm not sure that these fighters will retire. The winner will retire after this fight, or the loser for that matter. But I think we don't judge Muhammad Ali on the fact that he lost to Trevor Burbick or Joe Frazier joined with Jumbo Cummings. I mean, we tend to take in the totality of a career, and we tend to dismiss the fighters in the waning fights of their career. I do think that this fight will be a little bit more memorable than those because it involves two of these fighters rather than just one of them. But I think ultimately they'll be judged on how they performed in their prime and not in this fight.
In a fight such as this, I think all of the pressure is on Marvin Hagler. He's the big favorite in the fight. He's been active. He's the middleweight. He's the southpaw. He's expected to win.
If he wins, everyone says, so he beat a guy who wasn't what he was.
That's correct. The only thing he has to win is money.
Money isn't a bad thing to win, Gil. But who's going to win the fight and why?
Well, starting off, a fighter that's fought all the tough fights that Marvin Hagler fought, someday he's going to walk up the steps of the ring and the bell's going to ring and he's not going to have it anymore. But strictly on form, Hagler is the world champion. His natural weight is middleweight, and he's a southpaw, which I think is going to be the key, and the fact that he can switch so easily to the orthodox style. That's going to keep Ray from boxing. It's going to keep him from escaping. He's going to have to fight Marvin Hagler, and if he has to fight Marvin Hagler, you have to like Hagler in the fight. Alex?
Well, Gil talked about off the form. My difficulty in picking this fight is really that there is no form. Both fighters have been very inactive. Ray, tremendously inactive. But based upon what we know about both fighters, I pick Marvin Hagler to win a tough fight, probably a decision, based upon the fact that he's a natural middleweight. I remember when Ray went up from 147 pounds to 154 to beat Ayub Kalouli, another left-hander. He won the fight, but he got hit with an awful lot of silly punches, I thought. His reflexes weren't the same, and his movement was not the same. So I think that is going to be the decisive factor.
Mike, aren't we going to see evidence of that great reservoir of will and pride from Ray Leonard, who was such a great fighter?
Oh, I definitely. This is Ray's fight. He picked this fight. He was minding his own business, and he came out of retirement and said, I want this guy. So we know that Ray, from deep down, knows how to beat Marvin Hagler, both from a willful standpoint and from a mind standpoint. He has the strategy. I think Vito Antiferma ruined a generation of middleweights by charging this guy, and everybody thought you had to back Marvin up. The way to beat Marvin, I think, and I think Ray understands this, is to make Marvin come forward. Marvin doesn't have the greatest balance in the world, and as he gets older, He is no longer marvelous. And I think Ray can counter him the same way Mugabe was able, the same way Duran was. And I think Ray Leonard is better than those two guys were.
Can Pride beat an 11-year winning streak?
Well, the other thing is, I don't think any of us should underestimate Marvin's pride. I mean, he has a tremendous amount of pride. Ray does also, but that's part of the intrigue of this fight, is that they're two very proud warriors.
But Marvin's pride almost kept him out of this fight. It's almost as if Marvin is telling us he knows something that we don't know. That maybe this should not be a trip up the steps.
We won't know everything about this fight until it's fought, gentlemen. Thank you so much for joining us, and I will have a pick later on. A still camera does interviews too, silent interviews that capture essences rather than the tape roll of words that precede events. Here are Marvin Hagler and Ray Leonard in attitudes of calm before their storm. Last summer, trying to warn Ray Leonard about fighting Marvin Hagler without the proper preparation, I drew a parallel with John McEnroe. Like Leonard, McEnroe was something of a genius at his game. And yet after taking just a half year off at age 27, and Leonard is nearly 31, McEnroe was being beaten by his inferiors. Missing most was his competitive toughness and stamina. Ray, who is a co-commentator with me on fights, replied, "That's not what I want to hear." Understood. He needs support from friends. Now he has to understand. Fighters do what they must, commentators what we must. So this is to express support for his quest, if not his cause. Granted, genius has to be respected. But so too must history and physics, which agree that the stronger, more active, better conditioned man should win. 5 years ago, when Ray Leonard was as good as any fighter I ever saw, I thought he'd beat Hagler. Today, I don't. Will the fight be better late than never, or better never than late? We can only get that answer April 6th. For Barry Tompkins and the staff who put this preview together, I'm Larry Merchant.